Thank you. And can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus. The next item of business is a debate without motion on COVID-19, preparing for winter and priorities for recovery. And I call on Siobhan Brown to open the debate on behalf of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee. Around 8 minutes, please, Ms Brown.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's my pleasure to open this debate and speak as a convener of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee about our work on preparing for winter and our priorities for recovery. Presiding Officer, in March 2020, the world was caught off guard. We were not prepared. With the emergence of the Omicron variant last week, it is evident that the pandemic continues and the virus remains very much with us. Although we continue to live in this fluid situation, we expect this winter to be difficult, and in particular, we are preparing for a more challenging flu season. We have learnt through this pandemic that effective early interventions, often a lot earlier than might seem obvious at first sight, is needed to prevent harm and reduce the need for stronger intervention later. Presiding Officer, we need to learn from this pandemic and ensure that we are never in the position we were in March 2020, when the schools shut, businesses shut, and we were all told to stay at home. I will shortly be talking about the committee's work on baseline health protection measures in the run-up to winter. But first, it is important to stress that many of the issues which are raised with the COVID-19 Recovery Committee do overlap onto other committee work such as health, education and finance, just to name a few. The COVID Recovery Committee has taken great effort not to duplicate the important work done by other committees. Instead, we have focused on the ongoing public health measures being used to respond to COVID-19. At committee, we routinely consider regulations which put in place the ongoing changes to health protection and travel restriction measures. However, this inquiry allows us to get under the surface of the issues. In the new year, we intend to prioritise scrutiny on COVID-19 recovery with specific focus on health inequalities. This is an important debate, the first of its kind, with the opportunity for all conveners to speak about their committee's COVID-19 recovery-related scrutiny work. I'm looking forward to the contributions from other committees on their work and the Deputy First Minister's response. In terms of the COVID committee, we decided to undertake work on what role baseline health protection measures, in particular ventilation, could play in lessening the impact of COVID-19, especially over winter and as we move forward. We also looked at the measures needed to support long-term recovery. During our inquiry, we heard first from ventilation experts and then from those working in the health and social care services, the hospitality industry, business and leisure sectors, and schools. We looked at ventilation and the relative success of other health protection measures in helping to slow down the spread of the virus. We all know that one of the main ways the virus spreads is by inhaling droplets in the air, and that ventilation is one of the key measures used to reduce the spread through inhalation. Although I'm aware of the debate yesterday, prior to that, not much of the focus had been on ventilation to date. So we looked at how improving ventilation could be an effective response to a potentially worsening situation. With a difficult winter upon us, we want to do everything we can to prevent any closures of schools and businesses. No one wants that to happen. We asked witnesses what could be done to keep businesses open in the hospitality and the leisure sectors, how best to keep health and social care services open, such as GPs, dentists and social care centres, excuse me, Presiding Officer, and considered health protection measures in schools and the impact on young people. We were told of the challenges faced by retail and hospitality sectors and also heard of the importance of carbon dioxide monitors in assessing ventilation in buildings. We discussed the support available to businesses to improve ventilation and install CO2 monitors to reduce transmission, and the challenges faced by the leisure industry, which often uses buildings which are not always suited to ventilation adaptations required. In the health and social care services, we heard of the impact of the baseline measures have had in capacity and how services are delivered. We were told that doctors were continuing to provide a mixture of remote and in-person consultations to meet demand, and that mask wearing can sometimes be a challenge in terms of non-verbal communication during in-person consultations. I'm delighted to have learnt yesterday that new transparent face masks made here in Scotland have been approved for use in health and social care settings and will be in use within the NHS Scotland from this month. We were told that over 4 million dental appointments have been lost since the beginning of the pandemic, with baseline measures limiting capacity to 40 to 50%. We also heard the workforce in social care services has been affected and the economic stability of the sector is at risk. The vaccine certification scheme and possible extensions were issues concerning the business and hospitality sectors, although there's no consensus among the witnesses on whether the scheme should be extended. We will continue to pay close attention to that debate and scrutinise any proposed changes to the scheme through the appropriate regulations. Turning to schools, generally, witnesses were supportive of mask wearing in schools as a necessary measure to stop the spread of COVID-19 and to help keep our schools open. However, there was no consensus amongst parents about the wearing of face masks in school. Some had concerns over pupils' learning in relation to hearing and understanding and thought masks should be removed in classrooms. We heard of the challenges of achieving an appropriate balance between heating and ventilation in schools. Concerns were raised about increasing costs associated with providing additional heating and ventilation systems and whether heating systems would be able to cope with the worsening weather over the winter. We also took written evidence from members of the Scottish Youth Parliament about their general thoughts on COVID restrictions, how hard it was for them not to see friends and family during lockdown, and mixed feelings about the current restrictions, and I will quote one. "I have mixed feelings. I agree we need to be unlocked, but I don't like the idea of clubs being open because cases are going up again. I'm a bit unsure. I'm not going to go to a club. I'm not going to chance it. But with uni being back, I think that should be prioritised more than a club. I think some restrictions, seminars being in person would be good, but some people want lectures to be in person instead of online. Having 100 people in a lecture hall wearing masks doesn't feel great. So, what did the committee learn? Our inquiry showed me how much can be achieved through relatively simple modifications and forward thinking regarding the proper ventilation of our buildings. Although it doesn't exactly set the heather alight, we learnt about the simple things that can help, such as the use, wherever possible, of high-level rather than low-level windows. This prevents cold drafts while still providing good ventilation. Simple but effective. I would urge the Scottish Government to review the evidence we have heard and consider any new ways to promote the use of good ventilation to help prevent the spread of COVID-19. We've all got our mailboxes... Yes, sure.
Very briefly.
Sorry, thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the member recognise that a case rate for under 15s of 4 per 100,000, that actually the rates of COVID in schools at the moment is incredibly high, and that's with the government's current interventions on ventilation. Don't we need to do more?
Siobhan Brown, in closing.
Thank you. I thank the member for the intervention. I believe the Scottish Government are doing everything they can that has been advised by the experts at this time. But moving forward, I think we might have to investigate other options. We've all got full mailboxes regarding the challenge of non-compliance and current health protection measures, be it wearing of face masks in shops or people reluctant to get vaccinated for a variety of reasons. These are clearly areas where more work must be done to change the public attitude. We also need to think about how we build for the future and ensure our buildings are fit for purpose and able to cope with any future pandemics.
If you could please close now, Ms. Brown.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to finish by putting on record the committee's appreciation for the constructive engagement that all committees have had with us. I'd also like to pay thanks to the clerks to help and support the work of the committee. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Gillian Martin to speak on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to five minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, I welcome the opportunity to contribute to today's debate. And the committee took evidence from a range of stakeholders on seasonal planning and preparedness in health and social care on the 9th of November this year. As we look towards recovery from COVID-19, that evidence highlights the scale of the challenge we face. with the recruitment and retention of health and social care staff across all disciplines. Many stakeholders told us how extremely tired staff feel, given everything they faced over the period of the pandemic. Staff across nursing, general practice and many other health and care professions have experienced non-stop and persistent levels of stress and pressure, where they see no prospect of that improving, an increasing number are leaving the profession for the sake of their own health and well-being. And we heard more flexible working patterns are needed to address this alongside sustainable long-term workforce planning. On that last point, COVID-19 has impacted on employment opportunities, specifically for younger people. And we asked what can be done to encourage more young people to consider a career in health and social care. And with that in mind, I've written to colleagues on the Education, Children's and Young People's Committee to see if there's any way for them to explore this further in their skills remit. We also heard about substantial vacancies across all allied health professions, and that has a knock-on impact on provision of preventative health measures, in turn creating additional pressures in hospitals and primary care further down the line. Now, several of our health and social care colleagues pointed to the more sensational and negative media reporting most recently on GPs in hospitals and said that that was also putting people off from either coming back to work in healthcare or pursuing a career in health in the first place. Stakeholders highlighted other key contributing factors to this situation, the first being the lack of a sustainable education model to support workforce development for allied professionals. Again, we need to focus on encouraging more young people to pursue a career in these professions, working with partners in secondary, further and higher education to facilitate that. The second factor is a short-term approach to funding and late provision of funds to NHS boards, which creates an additional barrier to recruitment and workforce planning. And we also heard that return to work schemes could help bring back allied health professionals on a career break. In social care, we heard that staff recruitment and retention issues are now acute and worsening and impacting on the sector's capacity. 63% of providers responding in a recent survey said that they have had to reduce capacity for service delivery due to recruitment shortages. The training can take years for the majority of health professions, but by contrast, we heard social care workers can learn on the job and they could start tomorrow, yet there are still significant challenges. The main challenge is that working in social care simply isn't an attractive enough option for many. Currently, social care cannot compete with sectors such as retail and hospitality, offering similar or even better rates of pay and comparatively less pressured and stressful working conditions, and that this was a particular problem in more remote areas. There's a pressing need to look at improving pay and terms and conditions, as well as promoting the value of the profession of social care. Social care is there to support people to live well, live independently and live the lives they want to lead, and perhaps that isn't portrayed clearly enough in the rhetoric that's out there. Some stakeholders suggested a golden hello for those joining the sector could help boost recruitment and a loyalty payment could help support retention, but they also said that if such measures are to work, a consistent sector-wide approach would be required. Otherwise, we could see increased staffing churn between organisations if only some providers offer incentives while others do not. Those stakeholders that we spoke to acknowledged and welcomed the additional resources made to, available to them to support their well-being at work through this difficult winter period, but they did say that they're hearing reports that the key challenge for staff has been able to carve out the time to actually make use of those resources at a time when staff shortages means that they've been asked to take on additional responsibilities and to work extra shifts. So, Presiding Officer, to prepare for this most challenging of winter periods, we need immediate action to look after the health and well-being of our existing health and care workforce. And as we look towards recovery from the pandemic, a key priority must be to create a sustainable long-term plan to ensure we are building the health and care workforce that we'll need in the future. Thank you.
I call on Finlay Carson to speak on behalf of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee.
Bear with me, Deputy Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer. My apologies. Presiding Officer, the impact of the health crisis has been felt everywhere, but in rural areas in particular, the way in which recovery policies and priorities are delivered could have long-term impacts, leading to either more sustainable rural communities or further devastating depopulation with impacts right across every part of the country. Rural and remote communities and islands in particular have paid a heavy price during the pandemic. One example is of the many residents already experiencing loneliness because of the location, suddenly having to face being cut off further from society as villages and rural life suddenly became shut down for months on end. And that came with a disproportionately high impact due to the ageing profile of our rural areas. And those already suffering from ill health were forced to close their doors on the outside world, self-isolating for even longer periods. And we know that there continues to be a digital divide, which is growing as more and more aspects of everyday life requires the internet. And the impact of the lack of a reliable broadband service was even more strongly felt in lockdown, as many people couldn't keep in regular contact with their family members and friends. So it's important that while we start the planning on our recovery from COVID-19, that these issues are recognised and tackled head-on as a matter of priority. Public transport, or more accurately, the current lack of it, will play a major part in rural recovery. While passenger numbers have fallen dramatically on both buses and trains, I believe it's vital that provision of services return to pre-COVID levels. Now's not the time to be cutting back on trains and bus timetables, because we desperately need rural workers to be able to get to work, or the work will disappear. There is a strong argument that ideas like the 20-minute community model can be looked at through a rural lens and a possible starting point on how to address the all-too-often scenario of which comes first in rural areas. Is it job creation? Is it availability of workforce or housing or public transport? The answer is a difficult one, but we need them at the same time. As the convener of the Rural Affairs Islands and Natural, Environment Committee, my colleagues and I have asked that recovery policies are rural-proofed, which will ultimately slow and start to reverse the trend of rural and remote communities being depopulated with young people, families and potentially elderly residents now being forced to move into towns and cities in order to access services. We have a fantastic opportunity with more people working from home in rural areas right now, but we must ensure that these trends are not reversed. The important message is now that the pre-COVID recovery plans need to be rural-proofed, and that should not lead to or reduce end up with centralised services, with health, for instance, and we need greater support for rural GPs in order that residents can be treated locally, not forced to travel greater distances to larger towns. Among many of the issues that the RAIN committee examined is how precious and fragile our precarious food system is and how urgent transformation of our food supply chain is required. Scotland Food and Drink admits it's been on a crisis footing as a result of the pandemic, and it's revealed how many of us have been heavily reliant on exports that were found to disappear overnight with COVID. In committee, we heard from James Withers from Scotland Food and Drink in response to a question from Ariane Burgess that over the last 18 months, one of the silver linings to the very dark cloud of COVID has been the huge amount of support from the Scottish public and consumers for businesses in their area. The local food movement has taken a step forward, but that there needs to be an emphasis on looking at some of the challenges in the local supply chain. Although the food supply chain did a remarkable job in the pandemic, we have a very centralised system of food distribution, and the most resilient supply chains are often the shorter ones within communities. Professor Brennan, the chair of the Scottish Food Coalition, added that Argyll and Bute, which has shown huge innovation in how it responded to COVID, supported and was working creatively with local suppliers in what is, we know, a geographically complicated area. And it showed ability in contracts and bringing in, encouraging and mentoring and supporting new suppliers and reducing bureaucracy. Encouragingly, local convenience stores have come into their own during the pandemic, becoming more flexible, making their decisions more quickly and responding to changes in consumer demands. Indeed, their connection with local suppliers will grow with importance over the next few years. Local shops are and will remain absolutely central to rural communities across Scotland.
Throughout the pandemic, they've shown a fleetness of foot by changing where they've got their deliveries from, getting more local produce and working with people and suppliers different from what they would normally do. And that diversification of the supply chain is to be welcomed, and it's got to be a big plus for the sector. This needs to be at the heart of the COVID recovery now and continue to be the case. And creating relationships with local suppliers, especially in horticulture and the agriculture sector, is how the food supply chain in Scotland should develop and flourish in the months and years ahead. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call on Claire Baker to speak on behalf of the Economy and Fair Work Committee, and Ms Baker will be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to contribute to this afternoon's debate on behalf of the Economy and Fair Work Committee about our work on the ongoing impact of the pandemic, the position of the Scottish economy, and support and policies need to encourage investment and employment as part of the recovery effort. The committee wants to see support to encourage investment, growth, prosperity and employment opportunities while building resilience and protection against any future economic shocks. We have heard evidence from stakeholders on business, employment and skills, including the Economic Development Agencies along with Visit Scotland, and have identified a number of specific spending priorities for the Scottish Government's forthcoming budget to support and drive economic and business recovery for a post-pandemic society. We recognise there is a considerable opportunity now to challenge and reset what we do and how we do it. Of particular interest to the economy is the Fair Work agenda. The pandemic has disrupted our economy, creating further insecurity for many sectors. There is now a choice between trying to rebuild an economy which returns to our old ways of working or one that is driven by increased fairness and equality in employment. And many witnesses we have heard from in recent weeks have emphasised the importance of skills, and we will look to work with the Education Committee on taking forward this agenda. There were practical calls from businesses. They're asking for more of a one-stop approach to business, improved joint working between agencies, support which is more tailored to local needs. The committee recognises the creation of the Find Business Support portal, but as the Cabinet Secretary acknowledged to the committee, there is more to be done that can simplify the landscape. With a view to the 10-year economic strategy, which is imminent, it needs to match the scale of effort and ambition that is needed if we are to fully recover from the economy. Looking at the impact on SMEs, the effects of the pandemic have been uneven. While most businesses have returned to trading, many smaller businesses accumulated significant debt during the pandemic. FSB Scotland made a number of suggestions to help small firms, such as extending the terms of loan repayments, repayments only starting when a certain level of profitability is reached, and controlling costs such as non-domestic rates. The committee has asked the Scottish Government to consider these suggestions in the context of next year's budget. We also had a session on exploring support for SMEs in the move to net zero. While we heard about some good work taking place, we also noted concerns that many businesses are still in survival mode and may not feel at this point able to look any further ahead. Businesses are recognising the importance of the transition to net zero, but there is understandably little appetite to take on further debt to invest in the measures that are needed. The committee is calling for a clear roadmap for businesses to drive the necessary and sustained efforts they need to decarbonise. We recognise the pandemic has had a disproportionate impact on women's employment. They were in sectors of the economy which was the most exposed, and they were also in ones which were more vulnerable to the virus. The committee recognises the vital role that women play as part of the workforce, as employees, entrepreneurs and business owners. And we welcome the commitment in the Programme for Government to progress a Women's Business Centre, and we'd like to see this prioritised in the forthcoming budget to ensure women's contribution to economic recovery can be realised. As we consider winter pressures in the debate this afternoon, our inquiry into supply chains illustrates the pressures in our economy. We have identified the pressures of labour shortages and skill shortages, the impact of Brexit and our changed trading relationships, and the pandemic, which has created global supply chain challenges. And they are all under even greater pressure as winter approaches, and that brings a new set of challenges in our how to deal with COVID. That work is currently ongoing with the committee, and at its conclusion, we hope to bring forward practical solutions, including short and longer term actions that can be taken to support Scotland's supply chain as we continue through the pandemic. We also received evidence from Visit Scotland, and at the moment, the tourism and hospitality sector will be concerned about the emergence of the new viruses, and the government and I think the committee feel that we need to look seriously at their budget proposals to make sure they have sufficient support. And what is clear from the committee's work so far is that there are no easy answers for the challenges we face, but there are choices we can make about what sort of society we want to be and what our economy should look like and do for us. If the pursuit of net zero and the well-being agenda is to be core to our recovery, we must be realistic about where we are and identify and respond to that as the challenges arise. The forthcoming budget and the 10-year economic plan must respond to the significant challenges we face as we all strive for a recovery that is fair for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Kenneth Gibson to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Mr Gibson will be followed by Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to speak on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee about the priorities for pandemic recovery. Others have spoken about the devastating impact COVID-19 has had and the work their committees are doing to shine a light on the needs of the public sector and economy as we look ahead to recovery. Whatever the impact on our lives, health, jobs, businesses and the way we work, it has required an unprecedented level of public investment. That's why our committee was keen to look at the overall impact of the pandemic on Scotland's public finances as part of a pre-budget scrutiny. We found that in total, £13.6 billion was spent on Scotland's COVID response to date, with a further £500 million expected as a consequence of the UK autumn budget. While perhaps understandable in an ever-developing situation, we heard evidence that it wasn't always easy to identify and track the flow of COVID spend. This could become even more challenging as we continue our recovery. The committee therefore asked the government to commit to providing transparent and timely information on all COVID allocations. This will not only allow proper scrutiny of where and how effectively money is being spent, it also enables us to learn lessons for the future. In the early months of the pandemic, HM Treasury provided a funding guarantee of in-year resource to devolved governments, which gave more certainty to budget planning. With no such guarantee this year, the Scottish Government was in a difficult and uncertain position of having to allocate spend without knowing whether all the resources announced by the UK Government would actually flow to Scotland. There's no doubt this has made budget management more challenging here. In the short term, we've asked the UK Government to commit to a funding guarantee if the fiscal situation rapidly develops. Longer term, we've called on both governments to examine whether funding guarantees could be a better way of managing devolved finances. We also made recommendations regarding the upcoming fiscal framework review, which governs the budget process in Scotland based on the pandemic experience. While the framework broadly worked as intended, this was more by accident than design. The economic impacts were largely the same across the UK, with additional in-year Barnett consequentials. The committee would like the review to look at how the fiscal framework can be strengthened to withstand a situation where future health or economic shocks disproportionately affects one part of the UK. We know that some sectors, including hospitality, retail, leisure and travel, have been particularly affected by COVID, with some building up significant debt in the process, and Claire Baker talked eloquently about their concerns just a few moments ago. We therefore ask the Scottish Government to consider how it might best support these sectors to recover, rejuvenate the high street and grow the economy. It may not be possible within next year's spending envelope to provide a similar level of relief from non-domestic rates to businesses who struggled the most. Nevertheless, we welcome the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy's commitment to, and I quote, ensure that taxation enables businesses to fully recover and trade. We also understand the continuing pressures on local government finance, with lost income during the pandemic and additional reliance on reserves expected in 2022-23. The Scottish Government was asked to explore whether greater flexibility can be afforded to councils, enabling them to better respond to local priorities in the next budget round. The economic outlook for the UK looks better than forecast at the start of the year, Omicron notwithstanding. Forecasters recently revised up their expectations for growth over the next 5 years, falling stronger than predicted growth in the first half of 2021, supported by the vaccine rollout. The Office for Budget Responsibility expects the UK to now reach pre-pandemic levels at the turn of the year, surpassing February 2020 levels by January next year. However, while unemployment and economic scarring is predicted to be lower than anticipated last January, inflation has risen sharply, prompting fears of a cost of living crisis. This is evident in the cost of fuel at the pumps, heating bills and our weekly shopping baskets. Presiding Officer, we'll look to the Scottish Economic and Fiscal Outlook and the Scottish Budget on 9th December to find out the latest on how the Scottish economy is faring and how the Scottish Government plans to invest in recovery. Members will also have an ongoing interest in the framework for the upcoming resource spending review and the medium-term financial strategy, which is published on the same day, to see how the Scottish Government proposes to address some of the longer-term impacts of COVID-19. I look forward to exploring in more detail other aspects of the committee's report, including the pre-existing challenges to Scotland's public finances in our new year pre-budget debate. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Ariane Burgess to speak on behalf of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Ms Burgess will be followed by Ms Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, as convener of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee, I'm going to focus my contribution on the vital role local government will play in driving recovery from the pandemic. This was the focus of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny. The experience of the pandemic emphasised just how critical local authorities are to the communities they serve. Through the dedication and hard work of council staff and through collaboration with community and third sector workers, local authorities ensured that communities were able to access vital services throughout the pandemic. They continued to do this as the pandemic endures. If there is to be meaningful and transformative recovery from the pandemic, local government needs to take a leading role in that process. Simply returning to the status quo is not good enough. Any recovery from the pandemic must involve tackling inequalities, inequalities that have only been exacerbated by the pandemic. This can only be achieved with the full involvement of local government. However, to do this, local government needs to have the finances, certainty, workforce, and tools to deliver that transformative recovery. In the rest of my speech, I want to talk about what needs to be in place for local government to be able to play a full role in the recovery from the pandemic. Firstly, local government needs sufficient resources and funding. The intention of any local government funding settlement is to allow local government to deliver core services. In the current circumstances, leading the economic recovery from the pandemic is also a crucial part of the work of local government. It's therefore an important aspect of local government funding arrangements. Different views were presented to the committee on whether or not local government funding has or hasn't gone down in real terms. Irrespective of your view on whether or not local government funding has or hasn't gone down, funding is not keeping pace with the ever-increasing demands on local government, and that needs to be recognised. Presiding Officer, for local government to play a leading role in recovery, not only does it need to be sufficiently resourced, but it also needs more long-term certainty about resources. COSLA stressed how important multi-year funding settlements from the Scottish Government are to local authorities. Not only has the absence of multi-year funding frustrated the ambitions of local authorities by preventing them from developing long-term plans, but it also impacts on their partners. Without certainty about their own funding, local authorities are unable to make long-term commitments to their partners. We recognise that to date the Scottish Government hasn't been in a position to offer multi-year funding. However, with the UK Government setting out a three-year spending plan, the opportunity is now there. This long-term certainty would enable local authorities to work with their partners to make the kind of long-term plans that could help tackle inequalities and make transformative societal changes. I would welcome any update on progress towards a multi-year settlement. Witnesses also raised concerns with us about the extent of ring fencing and the constraints they place on local authorities to act flexibly to meet local needs. Funding provided to local authorities during the pandemic was to a large extent not ring fenced, and it enabled local authorities to act flexibly to meet the greatest need in their areas. I think we would all accept that there will always be some funds that it is appropriate to ring fence, but at the same time, local authorities were able to act effectively and responsively during the pandemic because of the flexibility afforded to them. The positive lesson of the pandemic must not be lost. The need for a fiscal framework for local government was also repeatedly highlighted to us, and we will be pursuing this issue in the context of our considerations of the local governance review over the coming years. The consistent message to the committee so far has been that local government, for local authorities to be able to act flexibly and to deliver locally. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Audrey Nicol to speak on behalf of the Criminal Justice Committee. Ms Nicol will be followed by Mr Leonard.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to speak in today's important debate as the convener of the Criminal Justice Committee. I thank the convener and members of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee for securing today's debate. I think it's especially valuable that we will have an opportunity to hear so many other contributions from a range of different committees this afternoon. And this reminds us all that COVID is not just a health issue, but one which has impacted on almost every part of our lives. And to echo the words of the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, when he last spoke to us about COVID, it has certainly not gone away. The pandemic is far from over. Like many other sectors, the virus has significantly impacted the criminal justice sector. As a committee, we have tried to ensure that the sector has been able to cope and continue to function to the greatest extent possible during the lockdowns. And as we slowly start to recover, we've tried to make sure that we retain some of the incredibly innovative changes to practice that the pandemic has brought about, whilst ensuring we carefully study government plans to make some of these permanent. As we said recently in our pre-budget report, any proposals must enjoy the support of the sector, and any fundamental changes to the way we currently conduct business must be carefully studied and the impact on rights considered. The balance of justice must not be undermined by any changes. Presiding Officer, I would like to thank everyone working and volunteering across the sector for their incredible efforts to keep the criminal justice system functioning. Their professionalism and commitment has been second to none. But let me also acknowledge the pandemic has left our sector with massive challenges. One of the largest is the backlog of cases in our courts, in particular our Sheriff and High Courts. As we heard recently, before the pandemic, there were approximately 1,330 trials outstanding in our sheriff and jury courts, and there are now in excess of 3,500. Every single one of these cases represents a victim who is awaiting justice, but also an accused who is waiting to come to trial. It's not surprising with these figures that the Cabinet Secretary recently told the Chamber that remand numbers have jumped to nearly 30% of the prison population. Presiding Officer, a growth of nearly 2,000 extra trials is challenging enough, but we also know that a significant proportion of these are for serious offences such as rape and crimes of sexual violence. That means many of the 3,500 trials will result in a conviction and imprisonment, putting yet more pressure on the prison system, healthcare sector, and voluntary groups that work in prisons, supporting education and training, and responding to drug misuse and mental health issues. We also know that it is likely to take years to tackle this backlog. Can you imagine the strain on a survivor of rape having to wait another 3 or 4 years for their case to even come to court? We were very privileged recently to hear from a group of just such survivors, and I can honestly tell the Chamber their stories, and the journeys were some of the most powerful evidence I have ever heard. We simply must take action to address the situation. Presiding Officer, let me conclude by updating that the committee will be publishing further reports, including on COVID recovery, in the coming weeks to set out our suggestions for improvement. And we look forward to helping in any scrutiny of a COVID recovery bill and will play our part in working with the Scottish Government and others to do all we can to recover from this brutal pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Richard Leonard to speak on behalf of the Public Audit Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I say that it's a privilege to be the convener of the Public Audit Committee, because the committee lies at the heart of parliamentary scrutiny and democratic accountability, guardians of the public purse, but guardians of the public interest as well, promoting openness, good governance and strong leadership, doing it in the cause of public trust and confidence, not just in public spending, but in public outcomes as well. And at no time have those principles been as important as they are today. The Auditor General for Scotland reported that last year alone, spending on COVID-19 by the Scottish Government was at least £8.8 billion. A further £4.9 billion is expected to be spent in 2021-22. This has been aimed at saving lives, at saving jobs, keeping our children in school and our National Health Service going. In the midst of human suffering and the awful loss of life, almost 10,000 of our fellow citizens have died from COVID-19 in Scotland alone. It has also rekindled a new spirit of social solidarity. Only last week, the committee heard at first hand about a new dawn of community empowerment in neighbourhoods across Scotland in response to the pandemic. But we have to make sure that this new dawn is not a false dawn, which means longer-term funding for the voluntary sector so that vital services are sustained. And it means as well that all public bodies, not just local government, but all public bodies must understand that they have an obligation to support and empower the communities that they serve. The pandemic has taken a disproportionate toll on the lives of young people and children, disrupting their learning, harming their well-being, and for too many, plunging them into even deeper poverty. This is set out starkly in the Joint Auditor General for Scotland and Accounts Commission report published earlier this year on improving outcomes for young people through school education. Put bluntly, pupils living in the most challenging circumstances have been the ones most affected by school closures. They are the ones as well, the ones less likely to have access to devices and broadband, to suitable study space, and the ones more likely to have caring responsibilities, which is why the committee agrees with the Auditor General that improvement needs to happen faster, that we need to address inconsistency across the country, and that we must start properly measuring our young people's outcomes, not just by exam results, but by their health and well-being, by their confidence, to make sure that they are going forward and not backwards. Audit Scotland has also reported that the number of children and young people waiting for more than a year for mental health treatment has trebled in the last 12 months. Sam H warns us that as we recover from the pandemic, there is likely to be a wave of mental health problems across our communities that is even greater, and that CALMS referrals will continue to rise. But we know that 1 in 4 of referrals to CALMS were rejected last year. And we know as well that no national data is collected to establish whether alternative services were accessed and, critically, what difference they made. So I say to the Cabinet Secretary this afternoon that it must be a priority for the Scottish Government to work with Public Health Scotland to improve the quality and scope of data on the provision of CALMS as a matter of urgency, but to improve the quality and scope of services as well. Can I turn finally to the vaccination programme? In our scrutiny of the COVID-19 vaccination programme report published by Audit Scotland, we heard that 90% of people aged 18 and over have received at least one dose of a COVID-19 vaccine. This is critical because, as the report highlighted, if you are not vaccinated at all, you are twice as likely to contract the virus. You are 3 times more likely to be hospitalised as a result, and 5 times more likely to die from COVID than somebody who is doubly vaccinated. And the truth is that people living in economically deprived communities, our younger people and some minority ethnic groups, are more likely to be in that unvaccinated category. So this is a matter of public health, but it is a matter of social justice and economic inequality as well. The road to recovery will be a prominent feature of the work of the Auditor General for Scotland's work programme in the months ahead, as it will be for the committee. We look forward to scrutinising further Audit Scotland reports. We will challenge government directorates. We will take to task public agencies, and we will take evidence from people on the ground. We will follow the pandemic pound, be guided by the facts, and so hold government to account. That is our job, and it is one which the entire committee on behalf of this Parliament and on behalf of the people, is absolutely determined to get done.
Thank you. I now call on John Swinney, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Parliament for the opportunity to respond to the important scrutiny work undertaken by the COVID-19 Recovery Committee and by the contributions of other committees so far this session, and we thank each of the committees for that work. This is a vital part of the process of parliamentary accountability, which will strengthen our approach to recovery. As we look towards an uncertain winter period, it is clear that the pandemic is far from over. We must all continue to take the appropriate steps to keep ourselves, our loved ones and our communities safe. Because of the measures we have all taken to control the virus and the outstanding efforts of those who have developed and deployed the vaccine, we find ourselves in a stronger position than we did last year. However, the real risk that the coming months could see a dramatic rise in cases remains very significant, especially with the identification of the Omicron variant and with the fact that we are moving into the winter period with less ability for people to spend more time out of doors. Public Health Scotland is working rigorously to assess how many cases of Omicron there are likely to be in Scotland, and they, together with local test and protect teams, will work to identify how the virus might have been transmitted and to work to break further chains of transmission. However, we should not await the outcome of this work before taking the necessary action. We must act now to reduce the opportunities the virus has to spread. As I explained to the COVID-19 committee this morning, the Scottish Government considers the state of the pandemic on a weekly basis. On the basis of assessing the case for proportionate action in the context of the evidence available to us, always working on the precautionary principle, given the necessity to act as swiftly as we can to interrupt the spread of the virus. Now, the Government has taken the stance so far, which was set out to Parliament on Tuesday, that rather than introducing new protections, we are asking people to significantly step up and increase compliance with existing procedures, including getting vaccinated, taking more regular tests, particularly in relation to levels of socialisation within our society in the run-up to Christmas, maintaining hygiene measures, working from home wherever that is possible, and the encouragement, as the Finance Secretary has been undertaking with the business community, to more organisations to enable more of their staff to work from home, and showing COVID certification where this is needed. I would like to use this debate as an opportunity to thank everyone who is continuing to play their part to protect Scotland. The work of the committee over the last few months has necessarily focused on baseline measures and our approach to trying to live with the virus. For that reason, I want to focus my remarks on some of the issues that arise out of that scrutiny and the importance of ensuring that the emphasis on baseline measures is a message which is clearly understood by members of the public and applied in the way in which we all live our lives. The vaccination programme has fundamentally changed the balance of harms associated with the pandemic, with the relationship between infections and serious health harms significantly weakening. That has been the strategic change in the way in which we are able to handle the pandemic, by the fact that we have a significant level of protection within the population. As of the 2nd of December, 88% of the adult population in Scotland have been vaccinated and 39% have received a booster or third dose. However, it is crucial to ensure, of course.
Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. Figures by Public Health Scotland yesterday show that parts of Glasgow, such as Finneston, Kelvin Hall and the city centre east, where less than 30% of people have actually had a second dose. How can we get on top of this?
Cabinet Secretary.
We have to take steps to make sure that the vaccination programme is available to individuals. I'm certainly satisfied that we have comprehensive availability of vaccination venues that are in accessible locations. You know, one of the questions that has been raised with us has been about the possibility of creating mass vaccination centres, and it's a point that Dr. Gulhani has raised in this chamber before. There is an argument to be had as to whether a wider range of locally accessible facilities, which maximise convenience and reduce travel costs for individuals, are a more reliable way of securing access to the vaccination for some of the people in the communities to which Dr. Gulhanley refers, or whether we should have those in more in larger, more centralised venues, which is what the Conservatives have been arguing for. I noticed, however, that Mr. Carson was rather arguing against such approaches in his contribution to the debate this afternoon. So what we've got to make sure is that we have available the facilities that are accessible to members of the public, and crucially, the communication to encourage and to motivate individuals. And the best messaging around that is the significant protection that the vaccine offers to individuals to reduce the risk of serious health harm as a consequence of receiving the vaccination. So the vaccination programme has a crucial role to play in protecting the public and in reducing the pressure that the National Health Service faces, which of course is significant as the winter period emerges. The Scottish Government has set out a significant NHS recovery plan set out on the 25th of August, and we've also set out the measures to invest in the National Health Service to ensure that we have sufficient capacity of staff, sufficient investment in facilities through, for example, the new national treatment centres, which will enable us to make progress on addressing the delivery of care, which has, of course, been interrupted for some individuals by the course of the pandemic over the last 18 months or so. So the recovery plan, which is focused very much on ensuring that we have the necessary resilience in place over the winter period, complements the work that is being undertaken to ensure that we have population-wide protection as a consequence of the vaccination programme. Let me turn in my concluding moments, Presiding Officer, to the issues of the COVID recovery strategy, which was set out to Parliament in early October. That is focused unreservedly in addressing the points raised by Ariane Burgess and also by Richard Leonard, unreservedly on tackling the inequality in our society that has been exacerbated, that existed before COVID and that has been exacerbated by COVID. So the strategy is unapologetic about focusing on the necessity to tackle the issue of child poverty, to do that by focusing on increasing financial security for low-income households, by enhancing the well-being of children and young people, by undertaking early intervention activity rather than waiting for CAMHS support, to make sure our interventions are as early as possible to enhance the well-being of children and young people, and creating good green jobs and fair work to enable families to be able to have access to higher quality employment. We've developed that strategy very much in collaboration with the local government community in Scotland. I will be chairing a joint board with the President of COSLA to monitor the implementation of the COVID recovery strategy, because we accept that there has to be an alignment between the government's activities, local government's activities, the voluntary sector, the private sector, to ensure that we make as much progress and in the work of COVID recovery. Because what COVID recovery has to be about is about ensuring we protect the population from the risks of the virus at this stage, but that we create a fairer and a more equal Scotland where every individual has the opportunity to prosper and to thrive. And that is the focus of the government's work on COVID recovery.
Thank you. I now call on Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, and I refer members to my declaration of interest as a practicing NHS doctor. Many of us learned a new Greek word this week, Omicron. But is Omicron more dangerous than the Delta strain? We don't know yet, and now we're on heightened alert. We wash our hands and we wait for the data. Artificial intelligence and data has been at the heart of the international COVID-19 response. Data is key to our amazing vaccine development and the trialling of new treatments. And without data, there'd be no contact tracing apps that go ping in the night. Data-driven innovations are also transforming how we do healthcare at large. For example, drones delivering medical supplies to remote regions and new optometry technology will soon be trialled to support primary care. So today's COVID recovery debate, I seek to make a case for data-driven innovation and how, if we harness for healthcare the world-class skills we already have in Scotland, we can build back better. The data-driven innovation and AI landscape in Scotland is thriving, though UK and Scottish government programmes are funding with major donors over £1 billion, and that's being pumped into innovation and skills development here in Scotland. In healthcare, Scotland has the greatness at its fingertips, literally. Scotland has the potential to be a world leader in developing, testing and proving medical technology. We just need to want it more and embrace homegrown, home-funded startups and university spin-outs. I would argue that we don't really have a choice. Now we have the spectre of 100,000 Scots struggling with long COVID. I had a very productive meeting with Humza Yousaf many months ago, but it does seem all this momentum has stalled. Whilst the announcement of money is welcome, actually providing help via long COVID clinics is what we need. Our NHS and social care services face huge workforce crisis and challenges. Yes, we can increase our medical school numbers by funding more places. I support that. Yes, we can incentivise experienced consultants to put off retirement, and this is possible. And yes, we can ethically recruit excellent qualified staff from overseas. I also support this. But we won't be able to increase our staff numbers enough to meet patient demand. We need to be innovative, and the solution lies in data-driven innovation. But it's difficult for our homegrown talent. Many get seed funding from us initially. But to get a foothold in our NHS, bureaucracy so often slams the door on innovation. Where are your past 3 years' accounts? Do you employ more than 50 staff? When you're lean and mean, you don't qualify. That's why we've lost some great ones to the US, where they've secured venture capital and built their companies over there. Surely here in Scotland, we should be adopting medical technology solutions at scale to manage patient care, shorten hospital stays, reduce hospital readmission rates, improve patient satisfaction and better patient outcomes. As one tech entrepreneur said to me yesterday, our smart startups don't want yet another government grant. They want their first order. Here in Scotland, we need a new model, a strategic innovation model, so our NHS regions can pilot homegrown, cutting-edge solutions that will improve healthcare delivery and efficiencies. As an example, I spoke with another tech startup company who've developed a remarkable antibody test using high-performance assays to detect new strains of the coronavirus. And this is five to six times less cost than we are paying at the moment. This technology has been heralded as a game changer. We need it. If we can crack this nut, we'll not only improve services and cut costs, will also help our smart young medtech companies to grow and capture markets overseas. Public support for data-driven innovation depends on trust in good governance, but we need to have the right rules and regulations in place that support, not hold back, our model of publicly funded healthcare. Innovation has been at the heart of our fantastic response to this pandemic. Let's pull together and harness innovation to see us through the crisis and into recovery, from Omicron to beyond.
Thank you. I now call on Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The impact of COVID-19 across Scotland has been devastating, and our thoughts are with those who have lost loved ones. Scotland has now recorded over 12,000 deaths due to COVID-19, and that is a heartbreaking milestone. But we are not through this yet. With the arrival of the Omicron variant in Scotland, the immediate focus must be on resourcing the test and protect system so that it has the necessary surge capacity, and urgently speeding up the rollout of the booster jab to eligible people. I know the Cabinet Secretary will agree with me, because that means greater use of mobile and walk-in vaccination centres and many more local opportunities for clinics. Members have, of course, raised complaints about vaccination centres turning people away, even though eligibility criteria has been changed from 6 months to 3 months. The government has apologised for the confusion, but it would be helpful to know when people can attend without being turned away. It will undoubtedly be an enormous task for vaccinators, with over 2 million people who are eligible for a booster jab yet to receive one, and something like 280,000 people have yet to receive their second vaccination. So let me thank the vaccinators in advance for their work. Happy to give
John Mason.
I thank the member very much for giving way. At the committee this morning, the question of waiting and drop-in clinics was raised, and would you accept that it's a challenge that if you have a drop-in clinic, more people may turn up than can be coped with?
Jackie Bailey.
Can I say that my experience, certainly in my local area, is that some of the drop-in clinics haven't had enough people, that letters, certainly in the Helensburgh end of my constituency, haven't arrived with constituents, and they have taken, I think, the novel of approach of just going to the vaccination clinics to get their booster jabs, and the vaccinators have welcomed that. So whatever arrangements are put in place, clearly it is about working at pace, and I think the government recognise that. Many people do remain uncertain about this Christmas, though, whether they'll be able to visit family and indeed whether they'll be able to travel abroad. And whilst we support a Four Nations approach, the Scottish Government does have powers in this area, and should they decide that there needs to be a quarantine put in place, can they make sure that this is accompanied by a package of support for the travel industry? And I would welcome any assurance the Cabinet Secretary can offer on this point. I want to focus my remaining comments, though, on health and social care. Because even before COVID-19, health services were struggling to keep up with demand, and there was a growing backlog of care. The pandemic has exacerbated long waits. There are over 650,000 patients waiting to be seen, and unless urgent action is taken, lives will be lost. Ambulance delays remain too long, A&E waiting times are at the highest ever recorded, and there is simply no capacity in our hospitals because the SNP have stripped out more than 1,000 beds, and social care is in crisis too. And whilst the number of COVID cases in hospital thankfully remains relatively low, any increase, as has been seen with the new variant in South Africa, would be a catastrophe. Staff are already working flat out and under enormous strain. So too are the staff in social care. Vacancies are increasing as people leave for other jobs in hospitality and retail because the pay in social care is so poor. Care packages are being cancelled because of these workforce shortages, and families are left alone to cope without support. Family carers have been the unsung heroes of this pandemic, as without their efforts, we would have struggled to cope. So where is their recovery plan? Where is their respite? Because in many local authorities, respite has simply not restarted, and family members are now being told that they need to step into the breach yet again because care packages can no longer be provided. The Scottish Government must act urgently, or the strain will simply become too much. Let's start with spending the Barnett consequentials of £165 million that remain languishing in the health budget, as yet unallocated. You cannot sit on the money because the NHS needs it now. Winter pressures have been with us for a few months now, and they could get even worse because we don't yet know the impact of the new variant. But we do need an adequate workforce planning in place because there is insufficient staffing. We do need increased bed capacity because there is a lack currently. And the current sticking plaster approach will simply not get us through this. Let me finish once again, Presiding Officer, by thanking all the staff for their hard work and dedication. Their goodwill may well be tested this winter.
Thank you. And I'll call on Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thank you too to the other speakers before me. It's important that we hear the work of all the committees and how the COVID recovery is being addressed by each. This afternoon, I want to reiterate the importance of vaccines, the importance of messaging by governments and public bodies, talk about long COVID, and finish with saying something of the resilience of young people living through this period. Firstly, I too want to pay tribute to our healthcare professionals who are exhausted. This has been a relentless time for them and everyone on frontline services. We know that the public are grateful. We used to hear it every Thursday evening in the streets, and I'm hopeful for the time when they can step down from the top tier of unremitting struggle. Scottish Liberal Democrats have proposed a burnout prevention strategy, a commitment that new staff will be trained and recruited until safe staffing levels recommended by the Royal Colleges are met. New toil and annual leave guarantees, backed by joint government and health board guidance, to guard against overwork, ensure that planning places a greater emphasis in guaranteeing staff leave and provide new protections around precious time off. Presiding Officer, what's been discovered in Southern Africa in the form of the new Omicron variant is a stark reminder of the existential threat posed to our own recovery by the collective failure to help vaccinate the whole world. It's only when we are all vaccinated that we will truly destabilise the COVID pandemic. The fastest way to end the pandemic is to ensure vaccines are available to everyone globally. We're all interconnected and interdependent. Our governments and public bodies must be clear on messaging. They have been on the need for vaccinations, and I would urge everyone eligible to go and get their first, second or booster jab. But this is a complex, fast-moving situation, and our governments and public bodies must strive to make things clear and simple. I observe that there's been confusion where messages for the islands can be different from those found in national media outlets. On long COVID, I have since the summer been asking constituents to get in contact with me and NHS Shetland so that we are able to determine the needs in the Isles. Scottish Liberal Democrats led the first long COVID debate in this chamber, and I'm grateful to the fellow members of the CPG on long COVID, many of whom joined Alex Cole-Hamilton and me in the debate a few weeks ago. As my party leader referenced to the First Minister today, 99,000 people in Scotland are now living with long COVID. Before I conclude, I want to reflect on the importance of our young people in the recovery from COVID. We know how resilient they have been through this and how much they are needed in the recovery. The Deputy First Minister will recall that I've previously raised concerns with him about the ongoing student experience. Young people are our investment into the future. We want them learning for all our sakes. We can't afford to have a brain drain. We need their talents, skills and knowledge. But people are telling me that they cannot understand why university learning is still mostly online, with students perhaps only in university for in-person lectures less than a day a week, while pupils and school staff can attend schools daily. One constituent told me that their young person would be better off flying from Shetland to their mainland university for a day each week, rather than spend most of the time isolated, away from home, struggling and learning online in small and expensive student accommodation. Presiding officer, we don't want to see high dropout rates in education as another consequence of this crisis. We need everyone contributing to the recovery from this pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I ask members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons? And I call John Mason, the first speaker in the open debate, to be followed by Liz Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to take part today. As a member of the COVID Committee in both the previous and the present sessions, it has been interesting to see how things have changed. And the committee was keen to use today's debate to strengthen the links with other committees and to try to ensure we are not overlapping with each other, nor are we leaving gaps that someone should be covering. COVID's impact has been so wide-ranging that economy, education and several other committees, many other committees, probably in fact all of the committees, have some kind of angle on it. And I personally am keen to see Parliament functioning well and having a joined-up approach as much as we can. I think one of the challenges for the committee has been in deciding exactly what its role is and what its focus should be. It was clear for the previous committee, ably led by Donald Cameron, things were changing so dramatically from week to week, that almost all we had to do was react to that. However, now that things have settled a bit and seem to be gradually improving, it is all a bit less clear. Moving forward, I think we do need to accept that in some sectors, at least, full recovery is going to take quite some time. Older people who might have travelled overseas as tourists, including both to Scotland and from Scotland, may well be wary for some time of making such trips, and that will impact the tourist sector. And most obviously, the NHS cannot possibly get waiting times back to normal anytime soon, or the justice system with its waiting times that we heard about as well. And I accept that it's hard to hear for many waiting for a hip replacement or similar non-emergency procedures, but I do not think there's really any quick way around that. Moving on to more specific issues, we face a number of challenges going into the winter, but one that concerns me is the number of people who are still not getting their vaccinations, and also those who are arguing against either the existence of COVID or against the vaccines as the main way of tackling it. Now, I accept that overall vaccination rates are very good and stand in comparison with most other countries, and I certainly do not want to see vaccination made mandatory. But we do see a reluctance or a hesitancy in certain quarters to get vaccinated, and especially among some ethnic minorities and also in poorer areas. Younger men in a constituency like mine have always been harder to reach by the health services, and I do not have an easy answer to that. So the committee will be focusing on some of this next Thursday. More serious are those who, for whatever reason, spread misinformation and downright false statements about COVID and the vaccines. This is perhaps seen most clearly on social media, but I have to say I do not entirely blame social media for that. Twitter, Facebook, etc. have been extremely useful for all of us and for the health services in communicating with the public. But let's also remember that we all as MSPs have a role to play in supporting and building trust in our health services. Of course, we need to be asking questions of government and others as to how the pandemic is being handled. Mistakes will inevitably be made, and it is right that these are explored and learned from. But we all need to be careful not to undermine the tremendous work which our doctors, nurses and other health staff are doing. Looking further forward, there's still a lot we do not know about. Over time, will most office workers return to their offices? And if they do, will it be for full time or just some of the time? We are not yet sure of these answers to these questions, but they will hugely impact on our town and city centres, and also how our public transport will react if there are no longer the peak time rushes that there used to be. Finally, can I just say thank you to some of those who have supported both the previous and the current COVID committees, in particular being able to regularly question people like Gregor Smith, Jason Leach, Linda Bald and Helen Stagg, to name but four, has been both a great opportunity and a great privilege. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. I now call on Liz Smith, who will be followed by Paul McLennan. Again, 4 minutes, Ms. Smith.
Thank you. And can I focus my remarks very much on the most recent comments that have been made by the business community, building on exactly what they told us 5 or 6 weeks ago when we had our last COVID debate in this chamber. And they are very much still of the view that whilst minimising the COVID threat absolutely has to be the priority, especially with the dangerous new Omicron variant, the second priority must be about developing our ability to secure a strong economic recovery, one that's sustainable not just for the short term, but for the years ahead. Now, that economic growth is absolutely critical, not just for jobs and investment and tax revenues, but actually to encourage a greater economic optimism that we also desperately need. So what is it that business is asking for, whether that's the Chambers of Commerce or the CBI, the Scottish Retail Consortium, FSB, as they face up to the ongoing pandemic, to supply chain issues, to the increased cost of living and national insurance increasings? First and foremost, they're very much talking about making their businesses secure for the future. The Federation of Small Businesses, and of course it is Small Business Saturday this weekend, is very clear that to complement the existing measures that have been agreed by this Parliament, we also need a package of discrete measures to assist with the small business recovery. And I have a great deal of sympathy with that, because I think small businesses are very much the bedrock of our economy, and they've been very much at the heart of our local communities during the pandemic. I know that's something that the Deputy First Minister recognises in his own constituency, and Richard Leonard referred to it in his own remarks this afternoon. And it's why the Scottish Chambers of Commerce have been so strong about the need to revitalise our towns and cities, not just in the short term with measures such as extending the business rates relief and the small business bonus system, but longer measures too. And the Scottish Government, I think, should be credited with some generosity in its approach over the last financial year in permitting some business rates relief, and I hope that's something that will be true in next week's budget as well. But business is very keen to remind us that the short-term measures, whilst they're very helpful, will not be nearly enough. The Chambers of Commerce and CBI want to see reform of non-domestic rate system and a planning system, and the SRC wants reform of the commercial property market. And of course, it's absolutely essential that Scotland is not at any competitive tax disadvantage with anywhere else, including England. But I also think it's very noticeable about how much business is focusing on upskilling and training and building an effective digital infrastructure. We know that unemployment has not risen quite in the way that we were once expecting, and we also know that job vacancies are higher than expected, which clearly tells us that there are some mismatches of skills within the economy and perhaps a lack of flexibility within the labour force, and it would be very helpful if the Scottish Government could spell out exactly what it's going to do to address some of these labour issues just as quickly as possible. But the critical issue is one that relates to the provision of greater certainty and stability. And I think these are the words that Kate Forbes used herself when it comes to economic policy making, to a much more coherent and holistic approach to that policy making and ensuring that Scotland remains fully competitive with other economies. They want a Scottish Government that fully engages with them, not just one that gives them a quick phone call to tell them that there will be some new regulations coming out in a few days' time. They want a Scottish Government that brings a clarity of purpose to both business support and planning ahead, and a Government that provides clear supporting evidence to underpin the decisions that it is making, because these decisions are absolutely crucial if we're going to have public trust in the way forward from COVID. And that's something, as we know, that there has been a great deal of confusion and contradiction at times. So I think this clarity of purpose is vital. Next week's budget, of course, is an opportunity. And I look forward to responding to that budget statement and to the engagement process between stages 1 and 3 after Christmas. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I now call on Paul McLennan, who will be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. 4 minutes, Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We face our second winter and our second Christmas in having to deal with COVID. Everyone is tired of the impact personally, but also on the impact it's having on our local and national services. The discovery of the Omicron variant is, of course, worrying, and it will be a few weeks before we discover the full impact. We all have to play our part in keeping the virus under control. As the First Minister indicated on Tuesday, the vaccine programme is our best line of defence. We all need to play our part in our own constituencies to ensure as many people as possible get vaccinated. And we heard this morning our booster programme is the best performing in the UK. Lateral flow testing needs to be a regular occurrence for us all, not only when we go out to events and socialise, but also on a regular basis out with. Only yesterday, we've seen a poll by Ipsos Mori showing that 84% of people asked held a favourable opinion of the Scottish Government's handling of the pandemic. The message is clearly working around about the vaccine booster programme and adherence to rules and regulations. COVID prior to the vaccine had a very telling impact in a number of ways and across all sectors of life in Scotland and, of course, in my constituency in East Lothian. In retail, many of our high streets were closed for months on end. This didn't only impact on them, but on the supply chain. In tourism, we've seen our highly successful tourist trade struggle as a visitor tap was turned off overnight. This week I've met with the aviation sector and with Mark Crothall from the Scottish Tourism Alliance. Both sectors are recovering, but they need their pipeline of visitors to build up for summer 2022. In care for the most vulnerable, we've seen our community resilience teams work amazingly over the months during the pandemic. I know in my own constituency they are ready to step up again. My thanks to Volunteer Centre East Lothian and to the area partnerships. I recently brought forward a member debate on mental health and COVID a few months ago, and COVID has exacerbated this issue, alongside highlighting other inequalities within our society. Now, my office manager, Lynn Jardine, made a very good point in recent meetings with anti-poverty groups. We've often heard the phrase in discussions, some groups in society were difficult to reach. She pointed out we should be talking about them about easy to ignore. We must continue to ensure we reach out to all of our communities and no one is left behind. Of course, the most important issue facing us is to relieve pressures on our care and health services. On care, we have seen pressures on the sector. The sector was, of course, impacted by Brexit, as well as our hospitality, farming and logistics industries. The pool of available people has been reduced due to Brexit and has placed pressures on our care services. The recent GCVI announcement and boosters for all age groups will, of course, require resource in terms of staff and buildings across East Lothian, Scotland and in the UK. The vaccine programme in Scotland has saved an amazing estimated 27,000 lives. Now, in East Lothian's share of the population, you're talking over 500 people in East Lothian whose lives have been saved. We just have to look at the large increases in cases across Europe if vaccinations fall behind. The balance between staffing hospitals and vaccination booster centres is very difficult and very much a balancing act. The quicker we can reduce pressures on the NHS nationally and recruit additional staff will return us quicker to a more sustainable delivery of services. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, every one of us in this building and everyone in Scotland must adhere to the guidelines now more than ever. Get the vaccine, wear masks, wash your hands and test regularly. We owe that to our retailers, our tourist sector, our voluntary sector and most importantly to our care and NHS workers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy, who will be followed by Willie Coffey. Again, 4 minutes, Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. On Monday, the First Minister addressed the country and offered new advice on COVID-19. We're once again at a significant moment in the pandemic. In that update, the First Minister announced that the first cases of the new Omicron variant had been detected here in Scotland, including in Glasgow, where I represent. The First Minister told people in Scotland to redouble our efforts to suppress this virus. The same must be true for the Scottish Government. We must see prompt action, and that action must be taken with us all and the long term in mind. We must avoid a situation where people are left without the support they need to live or the income they need to get by. The pandemic and all that's come with it has had a disproportionately detrimental impact on women, unpaid carers, BAME people, poorer people, older people and on disabled people. It has also had a disproportionate impact on the people in Glasgow. For these groups, things were already impossibly hard before the pandemic, but the pandemic has made things worse. Deputy Presiding Officer, I've made it my mission to be a voice for the people who've been left behind, and unpaid carers are one such group. They're terrified at what lies ahead. Families are having care packages cut as local authorities ask relatives to step up and step in where social care has been stopped and not yet reinstated. The social care system is not ready, prepared or resourced for another wave of COVID-19. And as a result, it will be unpaid carers, predominantly women, who bear the brunt. They are already broken. We cannot continue to lock down social care services with no end in sight. We need an effective track and trace system, something we haven't really had here, to protect people from the virus and allow us to remobilise key services like social care. When I talk to carers, they feel abandoned, let down and forgotten. One unpaid carer said last week of the decision to live with COVID that unpaid carers had been, and I quote, sacrificed at the altar of economic growth. This has had a huge impact on disabled people's human rights too. Inclusion Scotland have said that it was not just the direct and catastrophic impact of the virus on disabled people that has been a concern, but inaction, turmoil and indifference to their lived experience has shut them out and left us behind. Too many decisions have been taken about those groups without them. And I've said many times in this chamber that our recovery journey must not repeat those mistakes. We must take all of these groups with us, and that includes ensuring that decisions made as a result of the new variant and the need to double down on our efforts once more are made with the well-being of those that have been hardest hit in mind. This includes our financial well-being. The First Minister set out new guidance that should test and trace contact us, we must self-isolate regardless of vaccination status. This marks a significant change in guidance. The difference facing us now is that we have no furlough and much of the support and protections have gone. We do, though, have the benefit of hindsight. We can learn from where we went wrong, perhaps understandably when things didn't work, and we can support those who were left behind through this uncertain moment. That starts by ensuring that anyone who needs to self-isolate is able to without fear of losing out on income. Affordability must not be a barrier to isolation. That is why this week I've written to the Scottish Government to ask them to update eligibility for the self-isolation support grant to include people who are advised by NHS Track and Trace to self-isolate, not only those who are just unvaccinated. This is merely reverting to previous guidance. There cannot be additional restrictions without additional resources. The public are doing all they can to protect themselves and each other, and the Government must do the same and ensure that everyone, regardless of their income, is able to safely follow the First Minister's guidance without putting themselves at risk of ill health or hardship. We can't force people to choose between paying their bills or surviving the virus. There is much we do not know about the virus, but we have known from very early on that it doesn't discriminate against who it infects, and that without proper support, the impacts are disproportionately felt by those who were already facing significant disadvantage. And so, Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope the Government will consider seriously my proposal and give people confidence in the new guidance, and that they will reflect carefully on those who have lost the most this year. Learn from that, listen to them, and take action to protect us all.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Coffey to be followed by Gillian Mackay. 4 minutes, Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to place on record my thanks to the COVID Committee convened by my colleague Siobhan Brown and to all the committee conveners for their contributions today. All have made some really important contributions to our understanding of how the public we serve are feeling about the current situation. I was privileged too to serve on the committee in the last session, very ably chaired by Mr Cameron, when it was established pretty much as an emergency committee to consider the changes and regulations brought in to try to cope with and thwart the virus as it spread throughout the country. We've come through the early lockdown, the various levels of restrictions in different parts of Scotland, the emergence of and the life-saving impact of the vaccine and the gradual reopening of the economy, if I can put it like that. Yet COVID is very much still here. In the three full months since September, we have seen over 270,000 new positive cases in Scotland. That's 37% of the entire case numbers, presiding officer. And we've seen just under 1,500 deaths. That's 14% of all the deaths, presiding officer. That's just in the last 3 months. If there's anything we should learn about the virus, it must surely be that it will find a way to mutate and keep spreading. And that, presiding officer and colleagues, is why we need to try to keep a step ahead of it, to rely on science, on the advice from our experts, and to take the measures we think will protect our population, save lives, and help our NHS not to become overrun. I think back to the start of the pandemic and the tragic scenes we must all surely remember that came from Italy, with large numbers of people dying, communities in fear and in isolation, people singing from balconies to try and recover some kind of community spirit, and the heartbreak of losing family members without being able to see them. I recall then looking at Italy's figures at that time and thinking, this could kill 500 people in Scotland. And I also recall someone writing, this is what's coming our way next, and come it did. Now look where we are. We've lost nearly 10,000 people directly to the virus, and it would have been so much more, possibly 27,000 more, without the vaccine and without those baseline protection measures we have had to put in place to protect people as best we can. Make no mistake, though, we are still in a battle to save lives. The virus hasn't gone, and it's still killing people every day in Scotland and all over the world. Sadly, yesterday, presiding officer, we lost another 27 people to this dreadful virus. The COVID committee is right to be looking at how we prepare for winter and to look ahead at what our priorities for recovery should look like. Yes, they're deliberating on issues about how to have effective ventilation and CO2 monitors in our schools, our offices, our homes and businesses in the middle of a Scottish winter. And we have heard some of that debate today. It was really good also to hear the testimony from the members of the Youth Parliament about their thoughts and their concerns. So please keep taking that evidence as you carry on your work. Presiding officer, I think we owe the COVID committee, the various experts who offer their advice and the parliamentary staff who support it a huge debt of gratitude for the vital work they are all carrying out on our behalf. We are also doing what we can too on our committees. As we move into winter and grapple with the new Omicron variant, I sincerely hope that the members of this parliament can come together in the main to agree on how best to promote the public health measures that are needed to save lives. We daren't drop our guard, presiding officer. Far too many lives still depend on us getting this right. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Coffey. And I call Gillian Mackay, who will be followed by Craig Hoy. 4 minutes, Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I want to focus my remarks on how we can help public health recover from the pandemic. The Omicron variant is a painful reminder that we are not out of the woods yet and that COVID-19 is still a very real threat. The Greens have been clear that we need to take a precautionary approach and ensure that a range of mitigations and health protections is in place, including a robust test and trace system, asymptomatic testing and PCR testing for international travellers. It's indisputable that the pandemic has had severe and serious pressures on all areas of health and social care, and I would once again like to put my thanks on record to all of those who have worked so hard during the pandemic. Before the pandemic, Scotland was known for its poor public health. The sick man of Europe moniker has been hard to shake. I've said before that I would like to see this Parliament be the public health Parliament and that we need a renewed focus on improving people's standard of living and tackling non-communicable diseases. We should be building on people's increased awareness of their health that has arisen from the pandemic. We know that inequality is a main driver of poor health, and as we've heard, current cost of living rises have put a real squeeze on incomes. Everyone has the right to an adequate income to live on, and the Greens have long supported a universal basic income. At Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, we heard from Professor Sir Harry Burns and others the positive impact this could have on health and wellbeing. Although our preference would be for a UBI, I'm pleased to see that work on a minimum income guarantee is underway and I look forward to monitoring progress. We saw during the pandemic that emissions fell significantly along certain routes as we took less car journeys. Many of these routes are seeing a return to normal and those living, working and playing along them are again being subjected to a higher level of pollution. As part of recovery and in improving health, we need to tackle environmental harms such as air pollution, as well as health-harming products. We know that more people have been drinking at home during the pandemic, and this is contributing to more alcohol-related deaths. These were up 17% in 2020. We need to address the ubiquity of alcohol. Why, when we are constantly told of the health benefits of sport, and rightly so, do we allow alcohol brands to sponsor sporting events? Seems counterproductive to say the least, particularly when combining the fact that more people have engaged with sport at home, where we know more drinking has been taking place. There's also impacts this has on children and households. I've expressed my support for the uprating of minimum unit pricing. This policy was bold when it was introduced, but in order for it to continue to have an impact, we must ensure it keeps up with inflation. I'd also like to see mandatory unit, calorie and ingredient labelling and prominent health warnings on alcohol products so that we can be better informed about, so that people can be better informed about what they're consuming. We put calories and ingredient labels on food and other drinks, and we need to ensure that alcohol is not the exception to the rule. I would now like to turn to mental health. We know the impact the pandemic has had on mental well-being. The Greens are clear that everyone should have access to the support and treatment that is right for them, whether that be medication, counselling, social prescribing or inpatient treatment. We want to see treatment options diversified, particularly in the community. People should be able to access services through their GP surgery, for example. We also need to make better use of social prescribing. Clinicians' time to engage with social prescribing was limited before the pandemic, and as we know, health services are under more pressure than ever. Provision of social prescribing can also be patchy. Alongside an expansion in provision, I'd also like to see it made easier for clinicians and other professionals to signpost patients to resources and for patients to self-refer. Community mental health link workers will hopefully play an important part in this. To conclude, Presiding Officer, while we deal with the ongoing impact of the pandemic, it's never too early to set out our positive vision for Scotland. Now is the time to implement bold, radical policies to improve Scotland's public health now and for generations to come.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. Before I call our final speaker, I just remind members that anybody who's participated in the debate would need to be in the chamber for closing speeches. And with that, I call Craig Hoy for around 4 minutes, Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As members that serve on all committees of this Parliament will know, there is no doubt that COVID put a massive strain on our public services. This Parliament and the UK Parliament passed sweeping new laws giving local authorities, health boards, the courts, public agencies, emergency powers to respond to the pandemic. This allowed them to act quickly in the eye of the storm, often with little or no consultation. But this is not an approach that any democratically elected representative should be comfortable with. Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to touch on two issues, both relevant to my constituents in South Scotland and both in East Lothian. Both show the risks and the damage that can be done when public authorities act with little or no consultation. The first concerns the future of the Ennington Hospital in North Berwick, and it's something that I do hope that the Health Committee might look into. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Ennington Cottage Hospital is a valuable local resource. It has 9 beds for respite and palliative care and a minor injuries clinic, but it was closed, albeit temporarily, by NHS Lothian in September with no consultation. No consultation with GPs, no consultation with local residents, no consultation even with the Friends of the Ennington Hospital. The decision was taken by NHS Lothian and the East Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership under Emergency Gold Command powers. The Health Board says the move was taken to ease pressures caused by high levels of absence due to sickness and self-isolation because of COVID. But Deputy Presiding Officer, we know that patients do better when they are in their own communities, which is why local health services are so important. And that's why I think 97% of the 1,929 residents who participated in a recent survey I conducted said they wanted the hospital reopened. And I raise this now, Deputy Presiding Officer, because NHS Lothian will review the future of the Ennington Hospital next week. But so far, engagement levels have been poor. Poor by the local health authorities, but also poor by the government. At a recent meeting, Paul McLennan, MSP, said the Cabinet Secretary for Health had agreed to meet with local campaigners. But as of just a few moments ago, the chairman of the Community Council was still waiting for a reply to that request for a meeting. So I do hope that Mr. McLennan has not either overpromised or that Humza Yousaf is going to underdeliver. For, I will take an intervention.
Paul McLennan.
Just to inform Mr. Hoy, there has been an email sent to the Community Council this afternoon offering dates. And just to advise that, so if I'm quite happy to forward it on to him. But there has been a request sent to the Community Council asking for feedback on dates, so that's been sent this afternoon.
Craig Hoy, and I can give you the time back.
Super. I've just been in touch with the chairman of the Community Council, who's pointed out that there are just 4 working days until the decision will be taken on the hospital. And at that point, she hadn't heard anything. But I very much welcome the fact that the minister is going to reach out. In fact, there is a meeting at 6 p.m. tonight, and I have the Zoom link, and I would be very happy to forward it via the Deputy First Minister to the Cabinet Secretary for Health. The second issue of concern locally concerns the X5 bus. Again, an issue that was a development that took place with very little or no consultation. In early October, my office contacted East Coast Buses, who issued a standard response outlining the reasons for continued withdrawal of the X5 service. These included challenges with recruitment, the need to prioritise key services, and the focus on delivering the 124 service. I recognise these challenges, but I also recognise that they apply across all routes, across the whole of the Lothians, and not confined to the X5 route. So I do hope that East Lothian Buses will engage further, both with myself and local MSPs and also local communities. Presiding Officer, Deputy Presiding Officer, both these cases reveal the real risks of using emergency powers long term, and I do hope that once we emerge from COVID, that this is something that committees of this Parliament look into to ensure that local communities' voices are heard, even during emergency situations. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Hoy. We now move to closing speeches, and I call Michael Manna for a generous 4 minutes, Mr. Manna.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a very welcome debate today, and I have to say, trying to sum it up in the huge scope of the variety of issues is a challenge in itself. But it's a very small challenge in comparison to the many challenges that we've heard of today from all these speeches that the whole of this country faces. I was struck early on in the debate by Gillian Martin's continued use of the phrase, as we look towards recovery. And I have to say, it feels, I think, for many of us this week in particular, like a distant horizon, given the advent of the Omicron variant and the challenges that we can anticipate, that we still hope that it can be avoided, and God willing, if the results of current research into that strain come back in a more positive vein, then perhaps some of the plans that we've been talking about today may be more possible in the near future. But John Mason talked about the challenge of balancing recovery versus management, almost the idea of trying to balance these two competing topics, both in this Parliament and the functions of government. A question, I suppose, of what we are trying to do. And of course, the answer to that is both. But it's a particularly pressing challenge, both for the government to be able to manage, because we're absolutely clear that the scale of the present challenge across Scotland in our public services, in our households, in our communities, that people are continuing to face. I think Jackie Bailey was incredibly eloquent, and as usual, very grounded in the reality in our NHS and our social care services that people face. Beatrice Wishart spoke about universities and the challenges that they are facing, whether it be constituents having to travel and the challenges of online learning and that people face, and our hope to see those universities open up more broadly. And Pam Duncan Glancy talked about the challenge of disabled Scots, the absence of their respite services, which just in Glasgow, as she described, but also in my home city of Dundee, where respite services have not been reactivated, have not been part of the remobilisation, and the huge challenges that that then presents for people across Scotland and the families who are often the most hard pushed. So when we talk about the scale of that challenge now, and that we can also think about the huge disruption that we know is going to leave a very long legacy in Scotland that we are going to have to collectively come together and try and manage. And I thought actually the description of the challenges in the justice system that Audrey Nicholl brought out, the huge backlog in number of cases from, I think her figures were 1,330 to over 3,000. Now, those are staggering figures, and she was right to highlight that behind every single one of those cases is a family of a victim and people who are seeking justice and some form of resolution that allow them to move on with their lives. I've dealt with constituents who have been waiting for years already. And yes, COVID has come to them as yet another barrier and to having the emotional resolution that they hope for. And it's right that that committee has taken very close views of that. I didn't hear much in terms of what the solutions to that might be. And I have to say, in recent years, the closure of local courts across Scotland, removing capacity from our local communities to deal with those situations, I think has contributed to some of that backlog. And we do need to have a concerted effort from government to see what can happen to do much about that. We talked about the education situation. There were some highlights of the education challenges and, that we face in this country. And I have huge concerns about the COVID cohort of young people coming through our schools, particularly those in transition, going into primary school, going to secondary school, or leaving secondary school, who are without the familiarisation of their new environments, are struggling to adapt to that. Trade unions are coming to me saying we need to have a programme to address those needs, and urgently, and there's little evidence that that is the case. I close, Presiding Officer, by talking about, I think, Mr Swinney's focus on the issue of inequality and saying that that's to be at the heart of our recovery process. I have to say I'll believe it when I see it, I'm afraid. I've tried to be consensual in this, but this is during this pandemic. It was an election where Mr Swinney's party stood on a manifesto of regressive taxation, and they have not been allies to those of us who have argued for a fair society in terms of their approach to taxation and how that we might use the resources of this country to create a more equal society. So it will be judged in the first terms, in the next week, in terms of what is done on the pay for carers, meeting the £15 demand, and that can be the first step that can be put in place to ensure that we begin to actually build out of this, give people respect and realise some of the warm words instead of the cold comfort that we have seen from this government in recent times.
Thank you very much, Mr Murrah. I now call on Brian Whittle for, again, a generous 4 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be closing this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. I think I would start by saying that in committee, I have always tried to remember that we are called the COVID Recovery Committee and that we need to start looking beyond the current pandemic with an eye on how we enable society to recover where it needs to recover and to get back to a more normal pattern of life. In our private briefing this morning, I was suggesting to our advisers that the emergence of the Omicron variant was something that was predicted in a way that most viruses will mutate and that this pattern would probably continually be repeated as we move forward, that the battleground would be in science and medicine to make sure that vaccinations and treatments stay ahead of these mutations. However, it became apparent that the Omicron variant matches a worst-case scenario previously modelled by medical science. This, of course, gives governments the issue of balancing their response to this COVID strain while medical science investigates the Omicron strain against transmission rates, against serious illness potential and the impact that will have on the NHS, and vaccine effectiveness. During this debate, education was raised several times. Beatrice Wishes spoke about this in her speech, and governments must consider how school pupils can recover their education, and despite the huge efforts from teachers with the best will in the world, online learning is unlikely to be as effective as face-to-face learning, both academically and socially. And this can be demonstrated starkly in the rise of poor mental health, with one teacher telling me that 1 out of 10 pupils has been referred for mental health issues. As an aside, Deputy Presiding Officer, when considering mental health, I think there's a need to protect our outdoor learning sector, and that is paramount. We cannot afford to lose this educational tool, and I would ask that the Scottish Government support this sector. School heads are desperate to use outdoor learning, but insurance costs are now prohibitive, as Liz Smith and I heard just yesterday. John Mason's contribution, he discussed
how we balance the challenges. And in health, I have asked the Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach several times about the balance between COVID prevention steps and treatment against the rising issue of non-COVID-related conditions. Cancer identification or chronic pain, as well as many other conditions, will have a mortality attached to them. The current national death rate is sitting at about 12% above what is expected, much of which is not as a result of a COVID diagnosis. This, of course, is a dilemma, and I fully recognise the government faces that pull between treating COVID against non-COVID conditions. However, I do think it's incumbent on the Scottish Government to collect the data, as Sandesh Gulhani recognised in his speech, that we collect that data on as many conditions as possible, and this would undoubtedly help map the journey ahead and prepare us for what may be coming. As an example, I would highlight the need to collect data around what stage cancer is being diagnosed at compared to pre-COVID. This would afford crucial work for planning and give our NHS an indication of where resource will be needed going forward. Presiding Officer, I'm focusing on recovery, post-COVID if you like, although the truth is it is unlikely there will ever be a true post-COVID period. I asked Professor Leach his estimate for when normality would return, and he suggested next spring for the UK and 5 years globally, and I'm sure that will already be revised. In focusing on this recovery, I obviously recognise the real and present danger governments face right here, right now, in tackling COVID. However, recover we must. The current scenario must move on. It cannot continue indefinitely, especially if we are to continue to take the public with us. So my ask of the Scottish Government is, while working to tackle COVID, they are always aware of non-COVID health issues, educational recovery, economic recovery, and have a route map out of the worst of COVID. In the end, we have to believe that vaccines and medical interventions will deliver our pathway out of COVID. What happens next must be planned for, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whittle. I now call on the Deputy First Minister to close for around 6 minutes, generous 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This debate has been initiated by the COVID-19 Committee, and it's been my privilege since the election to appear regularly before the COVID-19 Committee. I did so on some occasions prior to the election as well. But I do agree with the comments made by Willie Coffey, to which I'll come back to some further comments that Mr Coffey made in a moment, about the role of the committee. And it is a committee which I think offers generally a thoughtful place to reflect on the difficult dilemmas that are at the heart of handling the COVID-19 pandemic. I would say generally a thoughtful place. Sometimes some members of the committee just can't help themselves, but I as always, am on my best behaviour in those situations. But one of the points that Mr Coffey made, which I think is important in his reflections on the work of the committee, what he's learnt from the expert opinion that the committee has heard from many, many sources, is the importance of not lowering our guard to COVID at any particular stage. And I think those are particularly wise words for us to reflect on this debate. Because at different stages over the last 18 months or so, there have been moments where we could have felt incredibly optimistic about what was the situation that lay ahead of us, only to find a development comes along to challenge us. Indeed, if I think back to just last week, a week past Tuesday, the Cabinet, in its assessment of the pandemic, took a fundamentally optimistic view of where we were, reflected that in the statement that was made to Parliament that afternoon by the First Minister, and by Thursday afternoon, we were dealing with the hard realities of Omicron and what that can do to drive the path of the virus. So I think Mr Coffey puts on the record some really important words about not lowering our guard at any stage. The other point, which I think is central to the work of the COVID committee, is that it airs the dilemmas that lie at the heart of handling COVID. And the committee will have heard from me, as Parliament has heard from me on many occasions, about the development of the Four Harms framework, which we developed last summer, in the summer of 2020. We did so because we'd taken dramatic action to lock down our society and economy in March 2020 for everything other than essential purposes. We had to have a means of establishing what was the safest route out of that and how we could navigate a way through that, and hence the creation of the Four Harms Framework, which acknowledged the relationship that exists between the direct health harm of COVID, the non-COVID health harms in our society, the economic and the social harm that can be created. And Mr Whittle has regularly revisited the questions about non-COVID health harms. Indeed, we rehearsed some of these questions again this morning at committee. And these are honest and difficult dilemmas to try to resolve, because if I share with Parliament one illustration I was making to the committee this morning, one body of opinion can pressurise us to speed up the vaccination programme, which could involve taking staff out of elective care to go into the vaccination programme, whilst another body of opinion is quite legitimately saying, can we have more elective care? And these are the dilemmas that we have to honestly air. Indeed, we heard some of those dilemmas in the debate today. Pam Duncan-Glancy talked about the fact that carers feel sacrificed at the altar of economic growth. Liz Smith was arguing for us to get on with delivering the economic growth. So these are some of the dilemmas that have to be wrestled with at the heart of the way in which we navigate our recovery from COVID, because what Liz Smith put into the debate was the aspirations of the business community to, yes, minimise the impact of the virus, but also secure recovery and growth. And I suppose I agree with both of those points. Where we won't probably be able to agree with everything the business community wants is that we want to do the same volume on each of those particular themes. Because fundamentally for me as a minister, I have to make sure that the public are protected from the impact of COVID to enable us to then move on to economic growth. And Pam Duncan-Glancy's point, I think, drew out some of the fact that we can try to make progress on the recovery of our society, but that risks, in her words, saying to carers that they perhaps are not as, do not carry as, or their interests do not carry as much weight as the move towards delivering economic recovery. Of course.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thank you for taking the intervention. I think the point that was being made by the unpaid carers last week was not only that they weren't involved in discussions, which I think is one that we shouldn't lose, but was also that so much seems to be open, yet health and social care services are continuing to remain locked down, and the impact that that has on them is that they are providing unpaid care and support to family members at a time when social care services are not back up and running in the way that other areas of the economy or of the society are. I think that's the point that they were making at that.
Deputy First Minister, I'll give you the time back.
Thank you, President. And that's an entirely reasonable and understandable point for unpaid carers to be made in that respect. I'm certain there will be dialogue with unpaid carers organisations that is undertaken, but I'll make sure that that is the case as a consequence of the issues that have been raised in Parliament today. There are, of course, a range of different tools that are available to us as a society to deal with the challenges of COVID, to enable us to make progress on recovering our society and whilst in meeting the challenge of not lowering our guard. That involves us all participating in the baseline measures around hand hygiene, around cough etiquette, around about physical distancing. It involves the use and the maximisation of the vaccination programme, which is an incredibly successful programme delivered by hardworking people on the ground with enormous levels of leading levels of vaccination levels within the United Kingdom on every single possible permutation of the vaccination programme. So there's a huge amount to be confident about the resilience that we have in place. And one of the other tools that would be helpful to have is financial flexibility. Pam Duncan-Glancy made the point that there should be financial support would be available in the absence of furlough. That's precisely why the First Minister wrote to the Prime Minister in the aftermath, along with the First Minister of Wales in the aftermath of Omicron, to indicate the need for us to have that sufficient financial flexibility to tackle these issues. Now, I think, yes, I will.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. I'll be brief. I also think I mentioned the letter I've written to the government asking if you would review the criteria for self-isolation support grants so that money is available to people if they need to self-isolate and change it to account for the new guidance on the Omicron variant.
Deputy First Minister, if you could begin to...
I will do, Presiding Officer. We'll consider carefully those issues. The issues of self-isolation grant support are absolutely material to making sure that people who are not in a financially strong position are able to fully comply with the arrangements on self-isolation. And, of course, that is material to interrupting the spread of the virus. So Pam Duncan-Glancy is absolutely right. That is a tool that we must ensure is effective in interrupting the spread of the virus, should that be the case. Lastly, Presiding Officer, let me conclude with just some remarks about the COVID recovery strategy, because I am very pleased that the Government has agreed that right at the heart of the COVID recovery strategy must be the tackling of inequality. Mr Mara will know that he and I part company on the rhetoric that he adds into the debate here. The big first test of the commitment to take measures on child poverty will be whether Labour decide to support the Government in doubling the child payment from April of next year. That will be the big test of the budget. We'll wait and see whether there's any rhetoric that we get out of the Labour Party about that question. We'll just wait and see what comes there. Because if the Labour Party decides in the spring of next year that it's going to find another excuse not to vote for the Government's budget, and it's not going to support the doubling of the child payment, that'll say to all the children and families around our country who live in a world of child poverty that the Labour Party is more interested in playing political rhetoric than they are in putting in place the practical solutions to the tackling of poverty. And, of course, this government will have no truck with that, because this government is prepared to put its money where its mouth is to tackle child poverty, and we'll see if the Labour Party is with us or not.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. I now call on Murdo Fraser to wind up the debate on behalf of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee. And again, a generous 7 minutes, Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. How splendid. Generous 7 minutes. Look forward to that. So I'm delighted to close this debate as Deputy Convener of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee, and can I thank all the members who contributed, and I listened to all the contributions with great interest, and in particular heard from all the other committees about the work that is being done in relation to COVID-19 scrutiny in committees other than our own, and that's really important. During our inquiry into the baseline health protection measures, it's been really helpful to hear from those working in health and social care services, in hospitality, business and leisure sectors, in schools, and a whole range of different environments on how they've been affected by the measures put in place and how they've sought to adapt. And like the convener, I've been struck how effective some relatively simple measures can be in reducing the spread of the virus. And I hope that our evidence sessions and the debate today will help highlight these measures. As politicians, we all have strong opinions and differing views as to what baseline health protection measures the Scottish Government should put into place. It's no secret, for example, that some of us have different views on the place of vaccine passports. But in the main, I think this debate has been free of much party political division. Well, with the exception of the Deputy First Minister, who did his best to wind up the debate just a few minutes ago. Willie Coffey, I thought, made some very important points in his contribution about the challenge that faces us, because it is a unique public health challenge that the country faces, and it's right that everybody tries to work together insofar as we can to face these challenges. And although we will disagree at times on the approach that's taken, in fact, in most cases, there is more that unites us than divides us. So I'd like to respond to a few of the points that members made during the debate. We heard from a succession of committee conveners. I don't know what the collective term for committee conveners is, Deputy Presiding Officer, perhaps it's a cacophony of conveners, but we heard from many of them, and it's interesting that there were a number of common themes. So a number of members spoke about the issue of health. Gillian Martin highlighted in particular issues around workforce in health and social care, who are under unprecedented strain. And in our committee, we heard a few weeks ago from Donald McCaskill from Scottish Care, who was talking about the issues in social care and how the big problem in social care right now are experienced care workers leaving the care service because of pay and conditions. And that is an issue that clearly needs to be addressed. Sandesh Gulhani talked about the issue of innovation in medical care and the opportunity that provides, how we can perhaps learn from some of the things that have been done over the past year, done differently, and how we can build on that in the future. And a number of members talked about the vaccination programme. Jackie Bailey raised concerns about the vaccination programme, which we, of course, were discussing in our committee this morning. And Beatrice Wishart highlighted the importance of vaccines. And a number of members, Richard Leonard, Paul McLennan and Gillian Mackay, talked about the issue of mental health, which is too often forgotten, and how we've seen this concern about a rise in mental health, which is perhaps exacerbated by lockdown restrictions, isolation, and in particular the impact that this has on young people, and how that leads us to consider the issue of funding for CAMHS. And then we had a number of members who spoke about the economy. Finlay Carson, Claire Baker and Kenneth Gibson, all as committee conveners, raising these issues, highlighting the need for ongoing business support. Liz Smith talking about the upcoming budget and what might be done in that in terms of ongoing rates relief for sectors which have been hard hit. And Claire Baker made a really important point about debt, because a lot of businesses have built up substantial debt over the past 2 years. And that's a real challenge, because we need businesses to be able to invest and move on to help deliver our ambitions for net zero. And that's going to be really difficult for them if they're already carrying substantial levels of debt already from the experience they've had over the past 18 months. Finlay Carson talked about the impact on rural communities. I think one of the really interesting things we're seeing is changes in working patterns driving population shifts out of cities. So we know there are people who previously had to work in a city centre perhaps 5 days a week. Now perhaps have shifted to a working pattern where they're expected to be in the office maybe 1 or 2 days a week. And that means they no longer need to live in daily commuting distance of a city centre. So I know of several families who've moved out of Edinburgh into Fife, into Perthshire, into West Lothian, because they can afford to buy a nicer house in a nice community setting, because they don't anymore have to make that daily commute into Edinburgh. And of course, if that is something which we want to encourage, and I think that's a positive for many rural communities, then that needs improved connectivity, it needs good transport links, it needs good broadband, and it also needs, as Finlay Carson said, improved rural services, such as access to GP practices, for example. And I think that's all going to be really significant as we look at the way the economy is going to develop in the years ahead. And Craig Hoy, in his contribution, picked up some local issues that were impacting on the people he represents that arise directly from that. We also see a very significant role for local government in terms of COVID recovery, and Ariane Burgess referred to this in her contribution and referenced some really important points about the need for finance for local government and the need for certainty to be able to plan ahead, and the need in particular for multi-year budgeting. And we look forward to the Scottish Government's budget next week, when we'll hear how the Finance Secretary will respond to some of these points. And Richard Leonard and Pam Duncan-Glancy both talked about the issue of communities and tackling inequality, and how that's been really, that will be really important as we move forward and rebuild society in the wake of what's happened in COVID. And then Audrey Nicholl talked about another aspect of public services, which is justice, and highlighted the impact there's been on that public service. 3,500 delayed trials. The prison population up substantially, with many more prisoners on remand, and the impact that has. And the enormous emotional impact on the victims of crime, and those who are waiting to give evidence as witnesses, and especially what that means for those who are victims of crimes like domestic abuse or sexual offences. And clearly there's a major social impact there. And finally, we talked a bit about what's happening in schools. Richard Leonard referred to this too, the long-term impacts the pandemic has had on pupils' learning, especially for those from deprived areas and those with additional support needs, and the negative impact the pandemic has had on attempts to close the attainment gap. So, nearly at the end of my time, Presiding Officer, just to close, I think we can agree that, you know, as we move into the winter, we now face this new an unexpected challenge, which is the Omicron variant. And we don't know at this stage exactly what that has in store for us. We don't know how serious it's going to be, but it's right we take a precautionary approach, as governments across the United Kingdom are doing. And that means all of us adhering to the current baseline protection health measures that are at the heart of the work the committee has been doing. So let me finish, Presiding Officer, by echoing the convener's words. We owe it to the people of Scotland to ensure there is strong parliamentary scrutiny of the measures proposed by the Scottish Government to respond to the pandemic, and I think that today's debate has helped enhance that scrutiny. Thank you.
Mr. Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a new member, I seek your guidance. During the debate that we just had, I said that the Cabinet Secretary for Health, who I see has now joined us, had not yet been in contact with North Berwick Community Council in respect of the closure of the Eddington Hospital. In an exchange, Mr. McLennan said that the Cabinet Secretary had, in fact, been in touch to set some dates. Immediately following that, I received an email that was sent directly to the Cabinet Secretary for Health from the Chairman of the Community Council, who says, "Hi, Humza, I'm watching the live parliamentary meeting. Craig Hoy, MSP, has stated that we are still awaiting a reply with a meeting date from yourself. However, Paul McLennan, MSP, rebutted this by advising that meeting dates had been sent to me earlier this afternoon. To confirm," she says, "I have received no emails from yourself or your office with dates. However, we would very much welcome this at your earliest convenience." Perhaps now that the Minister is here, he might be able to say whether or not that meeting has in fact confirmation has in fact been issued. And, Presiding Officer, if not, could I just perhaps seek your guidance as to how I might correct the record if I believe that it may have been inadvertently inaccurate?
For clarity, all members, if you could take a seat at the moment, Mr. McLennan, please, thank you. All members are expected to be courteous and respectful in their conduct, and this, of course, includes being accurate during proceedings. And I would say to the Chamber that while the point of order mechanism has been used to raise questions about the accuracy of contributions, these are not, in fact, points of order. Members themselves are responsible for the accuracy of their contributions, and it is not a matter for the Chair to rule on. As noted earlier, if a member believes that inaccurate information has been provided, there are a number of mechanisms available for the record to be corrected. Some of these include seeking to make an intervention, inviting the member to reflect on the accuracy of what has been said. If timing doesn't allow this, raise the matter in writing with the minister or member. And if relevant, pursue the point in written questions and follow-up questions or lodging motions for debate. And in the event that a member does wish to make a correction to information they've provided in the course of proceedings, there is a mechanism that enables them to do so. I would now like to move on. So that concludes. Point of order, Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I rise to make a point of order in relation to section 13C of the Scottish Ministerial Code, noting your previous comments, which sets out the importance that ministers give accurate and truthful information to Parliament. On the 27th of October, the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport was addressing Parliament on ambitions for COP26 when I asked him how many times had he personally met the UK Government in support of the Acorn project for carbon capture in Aberdeenshire. He informed the Chamber that he had done so on at least two, if not three, occasions in the past month alone. Information released through Freedom of Information of the Cabinet Secretary's diary, however, show that no such engagements with the UK Government ever took place. Despite the Cabinet Secretary calling the decision around carbon capture not coming to Aberdeenshire wholly illogical and that it will materially affect the businesses and communities in the north-east of Scotland, sentiments which I share, it seems there is no direct ministerial efforts or engagement to persuade the UK Government to invest in the technology in the north-east of Scotland. Our country and my region needs a Scottish Government prepared to knock any door, no matter how little they might like doing it, to make the case for cooperation, new projects and jobs in green industries. I am inquiring, Presiding Officer, what action you and the Parliament can take given this breach of the Ministerial Code.
Thank you. For clarity, members, I know that many members are aware. I appreciate this may not be the case for all members, but matters in relation to the Ministerial Code are not for standing orders and therefore are not for me to rule on. Such matters should be rightly addressed to the First Minister. Mr McLennan, point of order.
Yeah, thank you, Presiding Officer. Not a point of order, I think it is just to mention.
If it is not a point of order,
not
Mr McLennan...
Not a point of order, it was respond to the point that was made by Mr Hoy.
I think we're
just
not...
Just to set the record straight, he made an accusation...
Sorry, Mr McLennan, yeah. We won't engage in a debate with regards to Mr Hoy's point.
I'm quite happy to show him it. Thank you. Politics.
Now, as I was going to say, that concludes the debate on COVID-19, preparing for winter and priorities for recovery, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 2393 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and there is one question to be put as a result of today's business. And that question is that motion 2393, in the name of George Adam, on approval of an SSI, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.